Hello and welcome to Worcester for the first in a new series of Gower's Cricket Monthly. The Australians are here and they start the international business of their tour in just a couple of days' time. Of course, we'll concentrate fully on the Ashes this summer, but there's always plenty more going on besides. So let's show you now what else we've got in store for you this month.
Will the Aussies keep those Ashes? I've talked to Captain Mark Taylor and, of course, Shane Warne. We've David Boon on the challenge at Durham and his former Australian teammates. Derbyshire's Chris Adams shows a liking for pace is part of his driving ambition. The Irish are swapping Guinness for champagne with the help of Hansi Cronier. And we report on the ICC trophy in Kuala Lumpur, where it was Bangladesh doing the celebrating.
Well, England set off last winter with high hopes on their tour of Zimbabwe and New Zealand, but not everything went quite to plan. Even so, at the end of it all, out of five test matches, they'd won two and drawn three. Meanwhile, back at home, things were changing. The Testing County Cricket Board became the England and Wales Cricket Board and promised to revolutionise the domestic game. But under the new label, was it just the same old brand? Under that bright new packaging, was it just the same old product? We sent Jonathan Agnew to check things out.
Reconstruction appears to have been the buzzword at Lord's during the winter. The diggers moved in to tear down the famous old grandstand. There was more than just a slight tremor when this year's Wisden strongly criticised the state of the English game. But a saviour is at hand, a man who the authorities hope will direct the changes to our system, which surely are now inevitable.
Lord McLaren is the man who's been chosen to haul English cricket out of its current crisis and lead it into a brave new world. An enterprising and dynamic businessman, McLaren has made Tesco the country's leading supermarket chain, and he's taking up his new position at the ECB, determined to achieve similar results.
Well, he hasn't wasted any time in spelling out his views. Apparently, he favours two equal divisions with end-of-season playoffs, rather like American baseball. And there's even talk of him resigning if he doesn't get his own way.
He's got terrific presence. You know, when he walks in, we all tended to look up to him. We knew his background and so on. But he was an excellent listener. Asked the right questions. Tell me about this, tell me about that. Tell me what you need.
He's actually a businessman, and it's possibly one thing we've always lacked at the TCB or ECB. He knows about structures, he knows about the right people. He'll soon weed out the wrong people. And he's very forthright.
Lord McLaren is at the pinnacle of the new structure at the ECB, and the former Middlesex and Northamptonshire player Tim Lamb is the chief executive, who's excited by the opportunity.
Very much so, but it's an exciting job. We've now got a governing body which is responsible for the whole of cricket, not just first-class cricket. And I think there's a tremendous opportunity to move the game forward in a positive way.
And how radical can you be? It seems that you could almost restructure the whole game if you wanted to.
Yes, I think so. But it's got to be a phased plan. Rome wasn't built in a day, as they say. And, you know, it's unthinkable that all the elements of the plan are going to be implemented at once. But we do have an opportunity to look at the whole game. And I very much hope that we will be at least prepared to consider radical change. And that we can implement those changes as soon as possible.
For the first time, the views of England's county cricketers are being sought. The subjects range from a two-divisional championship to the ticklish question of overseas players and second 11 cricket.
Through the Players Association, we're going to send a questionnaire out to all our members, asking them about their opinions on the future structure of the game and how those changes might affect them and what they would like to see put in place. Whatever changes are going to happen are going to be far-reaching and they are going to affect cricketers. It is our livelihood, it is our game, we do play it. So it is extremely important that people answer these questions and answer them honestly and properly.
So much for the county scene, where opinions are still being sought, and generally the feeling is that changes will occur in the near future. That's already happened on the England front, where last year's supremo, Ray Illingworth, has gone, and with him his role. David Graveney is the new chairman of selectors, albeit with less power than his predecessor had, but despite that, he's relishing the challenge.
People have described it as a poison chalice and all things like that, but I don't see it as that. I haven't been able in my playing career to represent my country, so this is the next best thing.
Do you think that the problem was with England recently have simply been one of selection? Do you think that it all boils down to that or not?
No, I don't think so. I personally believe, and it's not just because I happen to be in the position I am now, that we actually have a lot of very good players. Our record in terms of under 19 and England A levels in our play against other countries would suggest that we can easily compete at that level. Somewhere we seem to lose the trail in terms of the competitive nature of our first team cricket, and I think that's the there are lots of views being expressed at this stage, but the one common view is the fact that people do believe there should be some change.
Graveney's balancing on a slightly delicate tightrope. He's also the General Secretary of the Players' Union, but he won't be responsible for disciplining the England team. Mike Gatting and Graham Gooch, two former England captains, make up Graveney's three-man committee. They're both still playing, so they should get the best view of potential England players.
What you do see is how players react at close quarters. You not only see their form from washing from the outer, from the ring, you see the way they react to certain situations, their characters, the way they react if things are not going so well as opposed to going well, how they're actually playing, talking to people within their side and other people on the periphery. You can actually see it in their eyes. I think that is an advantage.
The one thing that will be important, I think, is that the players will realise that, you know, they've got two guys, certainly, that are still playing the game, therefore we do understand what goes on. We both played Test cricket, so I would like to think the guys will be a little bit happier about the selection, whether it goes their way or not.
My motivation for being a selector is to help England win Test matches. That is the only motivation. And if my views as a current player and a recent past Test captain are thought to be benefit to the whole setup, as a very small cog in the wheel to help England do well, then obviously I'm happy to assist, and I assume the same for Mike Gatting as well.
The England setup is completed by David Lloyd and Mike Atherton, neither of whom now sit on the selection committee. Atherton has been appointed captain for the whole summer, which should give stability.
I think with the three selectors, the three Gs, Graveney, Gooch and Gatting, have recognised that we need stability. And I think there's nothing better than saying to the lad, you're the captain. Other nations say, you are the captain, that's it. We, by tradition, have said you're the captain for one test, two tests, three tests. We'll see how it goes. You know, a terrific vote of confidence for the lad. You're the captain for the whole summer.
Well, it's good news for me, obviously. I think it sends out the right message to the England team, which is one of stability, and it sends out the right message to the Australian team, which is one of confidence that we know where we're going and we're going in the right direction.
Everybody concerned is in total agreement that our game in England needs a very competitive winning England team. Now that perhaps won't happen immediately. I think that we need one, a cutting edge to the attack, and two, to win Test matches. We said that last season, or I said it when I came into the job. Somebody said, what are you looking to do? One, to ball teams out, two, to win Test matches. Not to have that rear guard action of a draw, we've fought out a draw, right? Take it on. Now that may take a little bit of time, but I feel that we're in place.
Even old Father Time's got a new home for this year, as all around him new foundations are laid, and the changes to the national setup will be beneficial eventually. One or two people seem rather impatient to get on with dismantling the county game.
But English cricket isn't like a supermarket. You can't simply restock the shelves with new produce and expect instant success. The roots of our game run far deeper than that. And the decisions the new administration reach over the coming months are far too important to be rushed through.
There are one or two changes already evident in England's squad for the Texaco Trophy. There's a recall for Philip de Freitas. Dean Headley's outstanding winter has earned him his due reward. And there are possible new caps for Ashley Giles and Ben Holyoake. Training this morning at Headingley, where the first in a three-match series is due to be played on Thursday, the squad appeared to be in buoyant mood, especially the Holyoake brothers, who explained how the news of their call-up came last weekend.
I was laying in bed on Sunday morning. It was about 8:30 and not too early a riser in our house. So got the phone call from Grav, and he said I was in, and I was very happy. And he said, and while you're there, is Ben there? So I went down and said, Ben, telephone call for you. And he was like, oh, who is it this time of the morning? So I said, oh, I think you better get it yourself, really. So I got up to get it, and then the rest is, I think he'd better tell you.
Basically that's what happened. I went back down and went to sleep. went back down to my room and couldn't really get back to sleep. Pretty excited. So it was brilliant.
So good luck to them. And now here's Geoffrey Boycott with his views on that one-day squad.
Well, I think the selectors have done a pretty good job with the Texaco Trophy squad. When you consider they couldn't pick Chris Lewis or Dominic Cork because of injury, they've gone for guys that have done well in the A-team this winter. Dean Headley bowled very well, took wickets, and he's put on a little bit of pace. Then you've got Adam Holyoake. Everybody's in raptures about his cricket, batting and bowling. Seems to have a good cricket mind as well. Then Graham Lloyd. He's a very fine player, started the season well with big hundreds, a good quick outfielder, and he's much quicker in the field than his father was. Then there's Mark Elam. I think he's a very fine cricketer. He bats and bowls well. I thought he should have been with England in Zimbabwe and New Zealand particularly this winter. The surprises for me are particularly Nick Knight. We know how good a player he is, but he's had an injured hand. He's hardly played this summer. He's short of runs, yet the selectors have gone with him. And Chris Silverwood, the young player of the year last year from my club, Yorkshire, he's a good bowler. But at the moment, he's just not bowling quite as well. He lost it a little bit in New Zealand after bowling well in Zimbabwe. He's not quite found the spark or the line and length that you need from a lively, fast, medium bowler. But all in all, I think they've done a good job. The two players that I think are unlucky are Peter Martin, the Lancashire seamer. He always bowls very well for Lancashire and England in the one-day cricket. And Ronnie Irani, he's a good player. Started well this season. Didn't get much opportunity in New Zealand, so lost his way a little bit. But this year he's making runs, batting well, confidence is high, and he's an occasional bowler. All in all, I expect England to beat Australia in one-day cricket. Me, I hope they're going to win, because I'm still in mourning for Eric Cantona, his retirement from Manchester United. So I hope England are going to light up my summer on Thursday.
That's it. That's a half volley through mid-on for four. The bat goes in the air. The England players come out to applaud what really has got to be a moment here of cricket history. Geoffrey Boycott, 100 hundreds, the place to get it in the middle of a test match against Australia on his home ground at Headingley.
Well, that was 20 years ago, in a summer when England actually won the Ashes. Now, there's a man beside me who's come across here determined to retain them for Australia. Their captain, Mark Taylor. Welcome back.
Thanks, David.
You're a much travelled man.
Very travelled man at the moment. International cricket's getting bigger and bigger all the time, which is good from a professional cricketer's point of view, but tough on the legs at some
times.
Well,
they always say they want to play, and you've got to sort of play to be paid.
That's exactly right.
Anyway, but you come here in some sort of confident form as a team. Certainly as a captain, you've beaten two good sides in the winter, West Indies, South Africa, good battles, and by the sound of it, with entertaining cricket.
Yeah, I think we're playing the right brand of cricket, and I think the crowds we've had so far in England suggest that. We're going out there to win games. Occasionally we're losing them, but so far we're winning more than we lose, so if we keep doing that, I'm happy.
I mean, the trick also is you won the games you won at the start of the series, didn't you? You always had the series under control before you lost matches.
That's been very helpful. We've won the first test and sometimes the first two tests of any series, and that obviously puts the pressure on the opposition and means they've got to change sides and do different things, which puts us in a good position.
Now, you've obviously worked out the formula. How do you rate England at this stage as your next opponent?
Oh, I rate England the same as I rate every opponent, always dangerous. You know, I always make sure we look at our side and make sure we play well. That's all I can do as a captain. I can't make England play well. I can only make them play badly by us playing well. So that's how I look at it. But a dangerous opponent. I think, you know, we'll start favourites in the series. And I think that sometimes that can be dangerous.
OK, now we know quite a lot about the players that have been here before, but you've brought some players who are new to English conditions. The likes of Matthew Elliott, Jason Gillespie. How are they going to do over here?
Well, hopefully very well. I think they're two talented cricketers. You know, Jason Gillespie's a real find for us in the last year or so. Fast bowler, he's got genuine pace.
Started well at Arundel, didn't he?
Yeah, he's got good control as well. So I'm very hopeful he'll continue what he started in South Africa. I think he was leading wicket taker in that series over there, which included McGrath and Alan Donald. So they're two useful bowlers to get past. Matthew Elliott, I thought, played particularly well in South Africa without making a real big score. He made 80-odd in the first test match there off about 100 balls. So, you know, I'd like to see him turn one of those nice starts into a big score, because he's got a very, very good technique and should be suited by English conditions.
People are saying you've only got a bowling attack of, say, four bowlers. That's not their weakness. Not really a weakness, though, is it?
It's something we've had for the entire time I've been in the Australian side. That's only 8 or 9 years. So We don't sort of have the all-rounder at six like we used to have, although a person like Greg Blewett or something like that could fill that role. We've always had the sort of the four-strike bowlers and mixed it up with the two Wars or a Bevan, something like that. So now we've mixed and matched our fifth bowler more so than had five specialist bowlers.
Just to confirm the power of this Australian side, the latest Coopers and Lybrand ratings show the War twins at 1 and 3 in the batting, and Glenn McGrath and Shane Warne ranked 2nd and 4th in the bowling. Glenn McGrath is a much improved bowler since England last saw him on their tour down under in 1994-95. On that tour, it was Shane Warne's leg spinners, not his seam bowling, that did the damage. Shane, welcome back again.
Yes, thanks, David.
Now, you had a great tour here last time round. In the meantime, you've had injuries, shoulders, fingers, you've had that crucial spinning finger redone. Is this the same Shane Warne as was here last time?
I don't think I'll be able to turn the ball as often, as big turners, as often as I would like, but I might have matured a little bit and got a little bit more experience over the last 4 years, David, so maybe I'm a bit more cunning as a bowler, but I'm looking forward to this trip. Everybody enjoys coming back here to England, and a lot of the guys done special things here, and I think it's going to be a pretty good tour.
But do you still rate this as the most important tour?
I think so. I mean, the history and the tradition in it all, as you know, David, that, I mean, it goes so far back, and everybody knows. I know personally that I lift that extra 10% when the test matches are on, and I know the guys do as well. Steve Waugh, Mark Waugh and Mark Taylor, Ian Healy, they've all done it before. And you just find that little extra 10%, and I hope people back in Australia and here don't sort of write the England side off too easy, because I think it's going to be a lot closer than what people think.
You're actually going to pay them more respect than seems to have happened so far.
I just think the England side are playing not too bad. I think Darren Goff back in the side, it adds a bit of spark, and I think with him in the side, I can lift everybody else around him. He's got that ability. As long as he keeps fit, I think it should be a really good tour.
Now, the English public will expect a lot more from you again. How much are you expecting of yourself on this tour?
I'm not one to set goals, personal goals. I set team goals, and my general rule is that I like to take that wicket that can change a game, and that's what I like to do.
You've
in a
done
test
that before.
Well, a couple of times I haven't as well, so it'd be nice to take that vital wicket that can change a game.
But you've always started, it seems, series against England well, both here last time 4 years ago, and certainly when England came to Australia a couple of years back. You were in there with a big haul straight away and sort of chock full of confidence right from the start.
Yeah, I think the first day of the first test always sets the scene of how the tour is going to go and how the series is. So, I mean, the first couple of tests are really important, especially the first day of the first test. And I know we try and really lift and perform on the first day.
Well, we look forward to some great cricket. Thanks very much.
OK, fingers crossed.
We can't do that. You never turn it that way. Worcestershire captain Tom Moody is one of seven Australians currently playing in county cricket. Another is David Boon, who was the outstanding batsman of their tour here 4 years ago. Having retired from international cricket, he is now captain of Durham. But he still has views on his former teammates, both old and new, as Simon Hughes now reports.
The Australians have just arrived here, some of whom were former colleagues of yours. Maybe you just tell us a little bit about one or two of the senior players that you played with over your career. Starting off with Mark Taylor, how do you sort of assess him as a player now?
Well, it's difficult. You know, Mark's had a pretty rough time of it over 18 months. One of his biggest strengths is his mental capacity and strength there. And I think he's shown that the way he's held himself above being able to captain the team in the manner that he does, which is very good. To hold his head up high in front of the media all the time when he's not personally playing well, and I think that's a credit to him, and you know, myself along with a lot of others are hoping that he can strike some form and get back to making a lot of runs that he did a few years ago.
And obviously it's going to be a target for England to try and make sure that he doesn't, because that could undermine the whole...
Obviously that's a tactic that will be used, and if we were in the same position we'll be doing the same thing to somebody else.
What about the best player in the side, the best batsman anyway, Steve Waugh? How do you assess his game?
Well, I think Stephen is one of the better batters with a tail, especially since AB retired. And but he's just a very, very classy player now. He's very strong, he's solid. He sits there at five and bats through with a tail, and I think he's just a tremendous player.
Would you advocate either of the Wars moving up to number three then?
Not really. I think Stephen has done such a good job at five, and Mark, I think, is a very, very good number four. So I don't think that should be really tampered with, and that'll be the big decision that the selectors will have to make on the tour as to who is going to open with Mark Taylor initially, you know, whether it be Slater, whether it be Elliott and Ponting at three, or Slater opening with Elliott at three. And I think that's the decision they're going to have to make.
A couple of words about the engine room, Shane Warne and Ian Healy.
Well, obviously Warne is a world-class leg spinner and probably the best one going around. I think, you know, he's been hampered by that finger for a couple of years now, but he's still bowled quite well. If he says now that he's 90-95% fit, I'd say that spells a little bit of trouble, that he's getting much more confidence under his belt and bowling quite well.
He's a big match player too, isn't he?
He is, he loves it. You know, Warne can be struggling, but as soon as he walks on the ballpark in a test match, he's right out there. There's nothing wrong with him at all. As for Ian, I think we all know. Aggressive, talented, solid, and, you know, has the team at heart for every minute that he's out there. And, you know, he's a great guy, a very good senior player, and he'll show tremendous support for everyone throughout the whole tour.
Now, you've been captain of Tasmania, now you're captain of Durham. Are there similarities?
Oh, it's difficult to say, but you can see occasionally, even in the short time that I've been here, the scars of the past still hang their ugly head over there occasionally. But I think I've been extremely impressed with the guys' attitude, and I've been absolutely really happy with the progression that they've made in the first month.
And you've introduced little things, like little bits of fun, like, you know, the fines committee. And I know I'm supposed to call you Mr. Boon as chairman of the fines committee.
Yeah, we just started that up, and it's just for a bit of a laugh, really, and to get the boys together for a quiet beer or whatever, you know, on occasions, and you know, provide some humour, and that's what that's all about.
The Boon Army, you're called, aren't you now?
Yeah, I've sort of taken aback a little bit by that, but yeah, the club has seen fit to produce a shirt for a couple of wins, and we just hope we live up to it a little bit for a little bit longer.
And just looking at the test series finally, you've given your surmise of some of the players. As a team thing, I mean, do you think Australia will win the series?
Yeah, definitely. It would be silly to say otherwise, but I think the series also will be a lot closer than what some people think. But I'm still picking our blokes 3-0.
He's out, OBW. Lily is gone.
And his bowling, and that surely is going to be it. That's it this time. He's made sure he's taken 5 wickets, he grabs a stump. And another memorable victory for England.
Well, when Ian wasn't battering Australians, there was nothing he liked more than just a spot of fishing on a good river. There's another big hitting batsman, Derbyshire's Chris Adams, who for my money could easily have been in this current Texaco Trophy squad, who prefers something just a little livelier. Here's Jonathan Ledyard to tell us more.
Talk us through it.
Oh, incredible. Speed, unbelievable. Like, you just think this is not going to go right. It's not going to go straight through here, and wham, mate, it's fantastic. Unbelievable.
Beat facing Alan Donald?
Oh, I tell you what, he's a slow bowler compared to that. I don't mean it in any way detrimental, but he's got a bit of speed to go to catch up with that. Unbelievable.
Chris Adams knows his rallying. He's been watching the RAC rally near his home in Derbyshire since he was a boy. But watching is one thing, driving with last year's British champion, Gwyndaf Evans, something else.
I was wondering earlier, I'm 27 now, I was wondering what comes after cricket, and I think I've just found it.
Is there a possibility, Gwyndaf?
Well, why not? As you say,
Yeah, a bit of practice and you'll be fine.
I was wishing that I'd listed chess or something in my interests instead of rally driving, but no, that was fantastic.
Last season was Chris Adams' best in 9 years as a county player. He scored more than 1,700 runs, including 600s. He averaged better than 50 for the summer. The rave notices were guaranteed to interest the selectors. After all, he hadn't let them down in 1990 when he took two catches as 12th man in the Old Trafford test against India. But for the moment, having been passed over for the coming one-day series, Adams remains an England batsman and slip catcher in waiting.
I think the squad looks fantastic. And I think we'll do very well against Australia.
You got the call from David Graveney, the chairman of selectors, saying, sorry, Chris. At least we assume he said that.
Yeah.
Was there encouragement there as well?
Yeah, it was great. You know, he didn't have to call me, but he did. I'm pleased about that. He just told me that, keep my head down, work hard, and, that runs talk in this game. And, if I get the runs, score the runs, then I know I'll get my chance.
You think you've got what it takes then? You can fill the boots of somebody in a test arena?
Of course, yeah. You know, I'm confident now that my game is in order, and that as long as, you know, I concentrate harder on my shot selection and work harder at batting for longer times, then, I can do a job for them.
How much has Dean Jones helped?
He's been fantastic. Dean Jones, Les Stillman, the coach, have been a revelation at Derby. We've had a bit of a mixed start this year. We've been very unfortunate with injuries, but their advice, their aggression, their positive attitude, and their mental approach to the game has been superb for us all.
And has Dean said anything in particular to you? Has he taken you on side and said, look, you've got the talent, but you just need to watch this, that, or something else?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I don't know whether he's taken it as sort of his thing this year to get me into the England team, but he's took me to one side, spoke to me, chatted to me. He's had a go at me a couple of times, quite rightly so. But hopefully it's all going to point me in the right direction.
He's always sort of needling you, get into line more, or the footwork, or something.
Yeah, I mean, especially when we bat, he's great to bat with. You know, he's sort of not only is he looking after his own game, but he's looking after your game as well. And he's always on it. Yeah, every ball is, a little comment from the other end, and it's great. You know, keeps you on your toes.
Do you think you could rise to the occasion in the Test arena? Because playing in front of a few hundred spectators at Chesterfield is not quite the same as going out at Lord's, and it's the Australians, and it's the Ashes.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, it's every cricketer's dream, you know, to not only play for England, but to play against Australia in front of 20, 30,000 people. You know, it'll be something special. It's something that, I'm going to make sure, I give it all this year and hopefully get that opportunity.
And Chris Adams with the three lines on his chest could be 1997?
Let's hope so. You know, it's something that, I said to Dean last night, I said, the gloves are off now. I'm going to come out fighting and do whatever I can to break through into that side, because it's definitely what I want.
With a nickname like Warney, courtesy of his county captain Dean Jones, Chris Adams will relish an early chance to impress against the tourists and their star spinner. And it's his luck. Derbyshire play Australia next week. So if the runs keep coming, the next call from David Graveney could be the invitation Adams has been longing for.
A few weeks ago, many of the world's smaller cricketing nations travelled to Malaysia to contest the ICC trophy. Ralph Deller went with them to Kuala Lumpur, and he reports now on what was a very exciting, if wet, competition.
Where in the world can a Fijian share a drink with a Bermudan, or Gibraltar's finest pit their skills against Papua New Guinea? The answer is the ICC trophy, the largest international cricket tournament in the world, with the top three nations getting a ticket to the next World Cup in England. 22 associate members gathered in Kuala Lumpur for the month-long event, brought here largely thanks to the song-loving president of the Malaysian Cricket Association, Tunku Imran Tuanku Jaffa.
What we've done is that we've managed to get government very much involved in this tournament, particularly because we've got the Commonwealth Games coming. So they've been involved in getting the grounds, sorted out and improving the drainage, etc.
Drainage was a big concern for the organisers. April is known as a rainy month in Malaysia, but the scale and frequency of the cloudbursts surprised everyone. At least the artificial pitches remained unaffected, but an outfield under several inches of water is not conducive to good cricket. Pity the Dutch most of all. They came to KL hopeful of reaching their second World Cup, but were undone in their quarter-final group when all their games succumbed to the weather. Holland lost two of them on the new Duckworth-Lewis rain rule, and despite valiant efforts by some of the team members to clear the water, they went out. After investing thousands of guilders in their team, it was a big blow. The UAE suffered too, not from the weather, but from the new rule limiting the number of expatriate players. They won the last tournament with a team drawn almost entirely from the subcontinent. This time, the local boys proved no match for the opposition and slumped to 10th place. It's going to be a long way back. Among many familiar faces was Ole Mortensen. Stan, as he's always known, spearheaded Denmark's attack in the previous five tournaments, and now, as coach, found his hardest job was preparing his team for the Malaysian climate. Saunas and heat rooms were the answer, something he discussed with the Scottish and Irish coaches.
Jim Love and myself and Mike Hendricks, we've been in contact, you know, how to prepare for this tournament. And we've done more or less as along the same lines. But that shows, you know, Scotland and Ireland, Denmark and Holland, all teams coming from the Northern Hemisphere, has done extremely well in this competition.
While Denmark and Holland finished fifth and sixth, Scotland in their first tournament and Ireland in their second contested the third place playoff, with a World Cup spot at stake. Naturally, the game was rain affected, but on the Keelak Club's artificial pitch and despite some spectacular Irish fielding, the Scots managed to set a target of 192. That proved more than enough. Jim Love's Scottish team fielded splendidly, and when Garfield Harrison spooned the last catch to Douglas Lockhart, Scotland had made it to the World Cup.
We've got a lot of youngsters back home who now have something huge to play for, and I think there's going to be an awful lot of competition for places, which is only to the good of Scottish cricket. The guys that are here today, they've got their foot in the door. It's up to them to keep playing now. We've got a lot of internationals between now and then, a lot of cricket to play, but there's something to play for at the end of it.
While the Scots celebrated, the two best teams made the final. Bangladesh, coached by Gordon Greenidge, faced the 1994 runners-up, Kenya, led by the player of the tournament, Maurice Odombe. Cricket in Kenya is a family affair. There have been no fewer than four Odombes in the national team, and they all started young.
There used to be a cricket ground next to the estate, so we could go there and watch cricket, and that's how we picked up the game. And we sort of started playing with maize cobs as the balls and using wooden bats for the bat.
5,000 locally based Bangladeshis turned up for the final. It's difficult to underestimate how much victory would mean to their nation.
Since the independence of Bangladesh, which was in 1971, there hasn't been an event or an occasion for the nation to rejoice. We are a fairly homogeneous country in terms of culture, in terms of language and everything else, but there are sharp political differences. And I think the really positive note has been the fact that cricket has been able to unite the nation.
Bangladesh decided to field and broke through almost immediately. But the cheering Bangladesh fans were soon silenced by one of the great one-day innings. On a far-from-true pitch, with a slow and uneven outfield, Kenya's Steve Ticolo scored the first-ever century in an ICC trophy final. He eventually holed out in the second-last over with 147 against his name. And even the King of Malaysia stood to applaud. Messrs Duckworth, Lewis and Rain set Bangladesh's target at a very stiff 166 from 25 overs. They scored runs quickly, but lost wickets steadily. And so to the last over, 11 needed, Khaled Masood on strike. That six and four frantic runs later, Bangladesh needed one off the last ball. But no one explained the intricacies of the system to the Kenyans. They thought Bangladesh needed two and set the field accordingly. So Bangladesh are the 1997 ICC trophy champions, the greatest moment in the country's sporting history. They'll be at their first World Cup in 2 years' time. And remembering what Kenya did to the West Indies, no one should take them too lightly. Two former winners of the trophy, Sri Lanka and Zimbabwe, are now test nations. Who knows where Bangladesh's triumph may lead?
So congratulations to Scotland on reaching the finals of the World Cup. For Ireland, there was disappointment, but they were soon celebrating on their return with a stunning victory over Middlesex in the Benson and Hedges Cup. It was their first victory against county opposition, so we sent our own Middlesex old boy, Simon Hughes, across the water to examine the progress of the Irish game.
What goes through your mind when you think about Ireland? Drinking, music, horse racing, football? Bet you don't think about cricket.
The Essex players had to, though, as they flew in to complete their Benson and Hedges programme in County Down. But there's rarely a dry day in the old Emerald Isle, and parts of the Downpatrick ground were more suitable for planting potatoes than playing cricket. It was a watery end to Ireland's B&H campaign, which began with such a fizz, beating a county, Middlesex no less, for the first time in their history. The toast was their coach, the former England seam bowler Mike Hendrick.
And he's bowled him. Hendrick strikes, Kapildev goes, and what a mess he's made of those stumps.
Two decades on, Hendrick swapped his England shirt for an Irish tracksuit and soon became intoxicated by the local spirit.
When I first came here in March 1995, the first couple of squad sessions that I attended in Queen's University in Belfast, there was a load of cricketers batting and bowling and doing bits and pieces, and of course I didn't know anybody at all, but the one thing that came out above anything else was their commitment, their enthusiasm, and basically a love of cricket. And I thought to myself, well, you can work with this. You can see a little bit of ability, but the attitude that they bring to their cricket is super.
The only other occasion when Irish cricket made international headlines was in July 1969, when their part-time players humbled the mighty West Indies on a sticky Londonderry pudding. The way the West Indies played suggested they might have enjoyed rather too much Irish hospitality.
Shillingford bowled by Goodwin for 3, and the West Indies are all out for 25.
In spite of the odd deterrent, Irish cricket is flourishing, with 140 clubs playing the game north and south and plenty of emerging talent. The daring stroke play of Decker Curry thrust them into the semi-finals of the ICC trophy in Malaysia. Curry, an abattoir worker, adds guile with the ball to his batting gifts, aided by wicketkeeper Andy Patterson, whose brother Mark, now on Surrey's books, offers a passable imitation of Dennis Lilly. Maybe for that matter Neil Doak has been watching South Africa's Jonty Rhodes. The captain, Justin Benson, a batsman reared on the hurly-burly of one-day cricket with Leicestershire, is an ideal figurehead.
I'm not from one particular area, which I think helps. You know, although I was born in Dublin, obviously I was educated over in England, so I'm not from one of the areas, so to speak, which I think perhaps they can relate to me a little bit more. You know, they don't feel that I'm from Dublin pushing Dublin people or from the Northwest. You know, it's an overall picture there, and I'm doing it for the best of the Irish team, not for any particular area.
The South African captain, Hansie Cronje, was dispatched by their visionary director, Dr. Ali Bacher, to give Irish cricket credibility. And Cronje not only gave the team added oomph, but also provided some guidance for the future.
I've enjoyed the time over here. I've seen 4 different provinces, the kids at the under 17 level. And I've seen some of the facilities, and some of it's good. Some of it is not that good. Needs to be improved, maybe. I really believe that if Irish cricket is serious about where they want to go, they need to develop the game at school level. And unfortunately, with the seasons and the exams, the season is only 6 to 8 weeks. And the first 2 or 3 weeks, you're going to have this sort of weather all the time. And it's going to struggle to develop the game. That's why indoor facilities are very important.
In Downpatrick, the indoor net doubles as a dining room. And sometimes the Irish welcome is so warm, it's easy to overdo the off-field entertainment. But most experienced county pros know when to stop.
It's an important game, it's not a benefit match, and unfortunately when the weather's like it has been, it can make you have a bit of a benefit mentality, or you get drunk and play a lot of silly games. But now, if we play, you know, come an hour before the game starts, we'll be keyed in, definitely.
Middlesex, it seems, were caught out on their visit 3 weeks ago. And as his team went down by 46 runs, the captain, Mike Gatting, could hardly bear to watch. As part of the Irish furniture for a decade, their former captain, Alan Lewis, deserved to taste victory and felt it wasn't just a freak.
I think the turning point was posting the total that we posted, 281. We talked long and hard about the reasons why we were failing in the batting, and I think the one area which we've improved on is this dealing with partnerships. Decker and Decker up the top of the order gave us a hell of a start, and really, with Hansey coming in at number four at 117 for two in the 23rd over, you're set for a big total anyway. But I think the most pleasing aspect of that for us was the fact that everyone played so well. It wasn't just a one-man effort.
Not a ball was bowled in the Essex match. So what of the future for a far-flung team who assemble periodically to play between the showers?
Somebody has to take a decision on whether we go semi-professional or fully professional, with not with all the boys, but with a certain nucleus of the boys. Get more fixtures against better opposition, play more cricket, train harder, get fitter, get stronger, and the thing will move on.
One man who would have certainly enjoyed the Irish hospitality sadly died last month. Dennis Compton was one of cricket's true greats, a marvellous batsman, a prolific run scorer, in fact a very fine all-round sportsman. And he was largely instrumental in helping England clinch one of their most famous Ashes victories back in 1953.
No, is it? Is it the Ashes? Yes, England have won the Ashes. And the race of all time. What a scene here. No policeman can hope to stop this.
Well, it might not be a huge trophy, but this is what it's all about, the Ashes. This is what England and Australia are going to be playing for this summer. And it's still one of my proudest memories, the day I was stood on that same balcony at the Oval in 1985, clutching these after a victorious series as England's captain. Let's just hope that at the end of this summer, Michael Atherton is doing exactly the same thing.
All this year's Test matches will be live here on BBC Television, starting at Edgbaston on Thursday, June the 5th. But we start with the One Day Internationals this Thursday. Highlights are on BBC Two at 8 p.m. And Cricket Focus begins this Saturday at 12:30 in Grandstand on BBC One. Geoffrey Boycott will be the regular guest there throughout the summer.
Don't forget, you can also catch me on radio every Thursday night on Radio 5 Live at 9 o'clock. That's it from Worcester. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back again with the next Cricket Monthly on June the 17th. Until then, good night.